your own version of corn. So we're going to see that today. For those of you that haven't seen me before at the association, I'm Ivan Hernandez, trainer with the association. My voice muffled. Need to speak louder. Like this loud? Yes? Annette Sweet. Yes, this loud?
Yes.
Hard to understand his voice.
So when you say everyone, you're talking about the Miami board too?
No. This is Palm Beach Greater Fort Lauderdale board. Yeah.
It's the same board because it's on Miami. Same
board. I didn't know I was going to be you, Ivan.
What was that?
I didn't know it was going to be you.
It's me. Yes.
I'm going to Fort Lauderdale.
It's the same board because it's Miami.
Okay. Some differences, let's discuss since I've been hearing a lot of form simplicity here. One of the things that form simplicity can't do is to help you with fax-through transactions. In addition, the e-signing is included with transactions. You don't have to pay the $62 per year to get e-signing going. So that's one of the major advantages of Transaction Desk, and we're here to see all those things in play today. First of all, how to log into Transaction Desk. You can do it directly from My Realtor Dash through the Transaction Desk icon. But it's also integrated with MLS. So aside from there being a link to get you into Transaction Desk, you can ask the system to send listing information over to Transaction Desk to help you populate the paperwork for the deal. So things such as the legal description, list price, maybe the other realtor's information will be sent over to Transaction Desk from MLS so that you can start working with. Let me log in real quick. Okay. First and foremost, we're going to understand some differences before we even go into the matter. Today, we're going to use a fake rental. I'm just going to pick a rental from MLS and send it over to Transaction Desk, and we're going to pretend like we're representing the tenant. But a couple of things that we all need to understand. Transactions, forms, authenticines, and documents. Do they all sign the same to you? Maybe? No?
Yeah.
Kind of. That's a common misconception. A lot of people think that, oh, they all sound the same. But no, each one has a difference. So I'm here to tell you what each one means before we proceed, because it's going to help you understand the material a little bit better. A transaction is like the folder that houses all of your paperwork. So think of it like a manila folder that you create for putting all the paperwork for that deal. A form. So a form could be a contract. A contract, one of those far bars that you use. You know, all you need to do is really customize it to the individual that you're using it for. Maybe customize the list price, maybe the rental price, maybe the days when the deal will be executed, et cetera, et cetera. The rest is filled out for you. So it's like a template. That's what a form is. You can customize the names of the individuals that are involved, prices, and you would change those every time there's a new deal. So that's what a form is. It's a template. Whereas a document is a read-only file, meaning that it's been fully completed. If anything, you could add an electronic signature to it, but you can't make any modifications to the document. So that's what a document is. And finally, both forms and documents can then be turned into authenticines so that you can give it electronic signing capabilities. And that's what the difference between all four of them are. All of them are accessible through the sidebar that's in Transaction Desk. So that you will always get into the agent dashboard, which is the home page of Transaction Desk. If you ever need to go into the dashboard, just click on this icon, which looks like a speedometer. Click on it, and it's going to get you to the home page of Transaction Desk. If you need to open up the icons just to see what each icon represents, click on this three horizontal bar icon. It looks like a sandwich. So if you click on the sandwich, now you have definitions for what each icon represents. You have Transaction Desk, which will show you all of the folders that you've created for deals, all of the authenticines that you've created, InstantNet Forms, which are all of those forms that you can then customize for each type of deal. And finally, the DocBox, which is a storage place for all documents. All of the documents that, like I said, are read-only, but you still need to have a storage place. These four can also be accessed directly from the home page using these widgets. So you have a transactions window, and it's going to show you your last set of transactions. You have a forms window, which is going to show you the last couple of forms that you've used. Documents, same idea, the last couple of documents that you've accessed. And then finally, all of the authenticines that you have created, all of the electronic signatures that you put into either a document or a form. And I see that there's a question here. I have a question. Is Instant Solutions a new paid option? I have used Form Simplicity for a long time. I'm a Miami Association Realtor member. I believe this is part of another association, correct? Transaction Desk, yes, it's a service that's provided, at least here in South Florida, by the Realtors of the Palm Beaches and Greater Fort Lauderdale. This is bundled in with the overall membership. To my knowledge, the Miami Association of Realtors does not have this product. So that's the answer to that. Thank you for your question. And as far as Space Coast Association, they might have it. I'm not sure. I represent the Palm Beach Greater Fort Lauderdale Association, so I can't talk about what Space Coast has. But if they do, that's awesome. It's a great product. Thank you for your question. Now let's go into bundling or using MLS so that it can help us then set up these transactions, because that's how you're going to start off with a transaction. You're going to create the folder so that you can put in all the paperwork for it. If you go into MLS, so I'm going to use Matrix today. When I pull up Matrix, we were going to work with a rental today. So let me just find a rental very quickly. Yes. And we're somewhere over here. Let's find something around our neck of the woods. Okay. Find this house. We're going to rent it today. So when we pull up the listing, we could print out the listing information so that we can then populate it into the forms. But instead of doing that, you click on the transaction desk icon within MLS, it's going to send listing information over to the system so that you can begin preparing that folder, that transaction folder. I'm still going to do it in a manual fashion, just so that you're not just bound by MLS. It's the easiest way to do it from MLS. Just click on an icon and it sends the information right away. But I still like to show you how it's done manually. And the manual way is by clicking on the Create a Transaction button within Transaction Desk. When you click on it, it asks you for a name, if you want to use a template, the type of deal that you're working with, and then if you want to import data from some other source. So clicking on the MLS button in Matrix would have done the following. It would have selected the source MLS, and it would have added this MLS number into this field, so you wouldn't have to do anything. It's not pasting. Copy. There we go. So Remember, clicking on the icon, it's going to do all that work for you. You're not going to have to figure out the MLS that that listing comes from. You're not going to have to fumble with that. You're not going to have to fumble with the copy and paste that I just had a little bit of an issue with, okay? In case that there's not a listing available, you can still use public records. So for those folks here, in which instance would you not have a listing?
If it's not on the MLS.
Right, and that's typically when there's what? Right, like if you're doing a listing agreement for the first time. So what you can do is instead of copying from MLS, obviously that's not an option, there's no listing, you can populate information from IMAP, which is public records. In IMAP, select the appropriate county, but it's going to ask you to put in, hold on, keyboard. All right, there we go. So the system is going to ask, enter a tax ID number, which means you're going to have to go into your appropriate property appraiser to find that tax ID number. Not necessary, because you can click on the magnifying glass. And even though we have Miami-Dade there, I can still change it while I'm looking for a record. So Broward. And then I would just enter the address of the property that I wish to start with. And that's one of the ways that that transaction desk makes it easier for you so that you don't have to fumble with adding basic information about any property. Any questions so far about that little feature? It's a great feature that will save you a lot of time. Let me close this because we're going to go back to our MLS example. All right, there's a question from Brenda. Will this also do the same with my Florida Keys MLS? I'm not sure the Florida Keys use transaction desk. That's something that you would have to ask your local association. They do have that service. This service, at least I'm representing the Palm Beach Greater Fort Lauderdale Board, and this is a service that we're offering to our members. Not to say that the Florida Keys Board doesn't have it, you just need to call and find out if they do have transaction desk of it. There we go. Okay. When it comes to creating the transaction, it's asking for just one required field, which is the name. What would you name this transaction? Anyone here that?
Property address.
Yes. One of the things that I hear a lot are agents saying, well, I'm going to give this folder the name of the client that I'm working with. Okay, you could go that route. The only problem with that is that today we're working with a rent, and we're going to say that our landlord or our tenant, our client, is going to be Michael Jordan. And Michael Jordan is going to be renting from LeBron James. You know, funny how things change after a couple of years, but things happen. So if we're representing Michael Jordan today, and Michael Jordan falls in love with this home, and then maybe he would like to buy it later on, because we named the rental transaction Michael Jordan, and when Michael Jordan decides to buy it, we call it Michael Jordan again, we're not going to be able to tell apart which one is which in an easy way. So what I recommend is for the name of the transaction folder, call it the address, and give it a description, rental. So the address today is 1790 Southeast 3rd Street, 1790. On keyboard, there we go. 1790 Southeast 3rd Street. By using the integration from MLS, the name of or the address of the property would have already shown up there. So that's something else that it will do for you. Yes, ma'am, I have a question here.
Or you could also put the address along with the person's last name.
Sure. All of these options are just tips that I can give you. There's no right or wrong answer. It's just suggestions that I give you based on all the training that I do. I think that the address and just a brief description of the type of deal that you're doing works the best, but you can use whatever works for you. So 1790 Southeast 3rd Street, and then I'm going to put /rental. If anything, I'm going to say M. Jordan. Yeah, we go that route. Works out for you. Template. So the template, even though it's not a required field, I would suggest that you try to use templates as much as possible. Essentially, what a template is a package that you've already set up. Package of forms, package of documents, package of people. And all of these things that you've added into this package will already populate into the transaction folder for you. So you don't have to pick them out. I have some demo ones that I've created. I have a condo rentals packet. I have a listing agreement packet. I have a residential purchase packet in which I already have the forms that I need for that type of scenario, any documents that I need to include for that scenario, and if anything, people, contacts. Typical examples of scenarios in which you would need to add a contact. Let's say that the office has a preferred lender, preferred title company, or you have a preferred appraiser, I don't know. Someone preferred, and you know you have to include them into the deal every single time. You can add them as a contact. So what we're going to do now is we're going to see how to set up one of these templates, because the templates need to be set up by each user. So what I'm going to do is I'm back at the home page, and I'm going to go into setup. Bottom left, the icon looks like three gears. So when you click on setup, you're going to go into transaction templates. And in here on the top right corner, you can click on the add button so that you can begin creating a transaction template. The only thing it's going to ask for you to put in is a label, maybe the type of deal. And then after that, it's going to ask you if you want to add forms, documents, clients, if anything, also a checklist. A checklist, we're not going to talk about it in depth today, but the gist of a checklist is essentially something that tells you what you need to do within a deal, and you can check it off after it's done. Checklist. So I'm going to click on add, and my type of account gives me this ownership box. You won't have that box, so don't disregard the ownership one, but you will have name, type, and description. So the name, it's a label. Make sure it's an easy label so that you are familiar with the contents of that template. Keep in mind that same label you put in here is the label that you will see when you click on this drop down as you're creating the transaction folder. So just make it something easy. I'm going to do the one for today's type of deal. Today we're working with a single family rental. I'm going to say single, keyboard again. There we go. Single family rental package. Why not? Call it that. So the type, for those folks here, what would the type be? Or anyone on the chat? So we have residential lease, condo lease, residential lease, right?
Yeah.
On a rental. Mm-hmm. Residential lease. And then you can create a description. You can add a description. The description is only visible when you go to edit these. So it's like a note that you can write yourself saying, oh, this is the package that includes this form and this other form and this other form. It's not mandatory for you to add a description. Today we're just going to leave it blank, but you get the idea. It's just a personal note. Hit save, and now Transaction Desk wants you to add the contents of this template. So those are the checklists that I mentioned earlier that you can add. You can add preferred contacts, and those will be contacts that are required for a single family rental. You know, documents and folders, or any documents that need to go into the transaction folder. Common examples would be any disclosures coming from the brokerage that are fully written out. And if anything, you just need to capture a signature from either the landlord or the tenant. You're not making any updates to it. Forms. So we're going to add the forms. The forms are available from the Florida Association of Realtors and the Florida Bar, the FAR Bar. So when I click on forms, All I need to do is click on the plus sign, top right. And it's going to give me the database of all of the forms available for all Florida realtors. I could go to the folder that talks about FAR leases, contracts to lease, and supplements. But if I already know that I need a contract to lease, I can simply type in keywords that will help me locate those forms. So I'm going to say contract, keyword. It's the keyboard, I promise. Okay. Okay. I'm trying. Could it be the battery? Contract to lease. Contract lease. And see how it filters down and narrows down to only the contract to lease. So what you do is you select it and it adds it to a basket. Think of this like going to Publix, going aisle by aisle. So you're in aisle one, you get the contract to lease. Erase the term that you put in there and start searching for the next form that you wish to add. You're now going to aisle two. So I'm going to go and look for the single family lease. Didn't find it. Maybe I just need to say single family. There we go. Single family home and duplex. I select it, and now it adds it to the basket. If I change my mind, click on the basket, hit the minus sign, and it's going to remove that one form. But if you're okay with these two, hit add, and now you've created a transaction template that anytime you want to start a transaction folder and you say single family rental package, it's going to add those two forms for you. So it makes it quicker. Say if I already, on my original example, if I already had single family rentals packet, or we were working with a condo today, then I wouldn't have to worry about adding the forms again and the documents again, except. So are there any questions about the transaction template? It's something that's going to save you a lot of time, very easy to set up. You only have to set it up once. I get this question asked a lot. Ivan, so if the Florida Association of Realtors or the Florida Bar makes an amendment or a change to one of these forms, do I have to go and update the template? No. The content of the form will still be the same, or will update based on any changes by the Florida Bar or FAF. Any questions from the chat? Everyone good? Give you guys a couple of seconds while I take a break. Okay, no questions. Simple enough, right? Today's example, I'm not even going to use a template. I still want to show you the manual way of doing things. Just in case you forget to create a template, you're not stuck. You can just add a manual. So I'm going to bypass the template box. The type, residential lease. So even though it's not a required field, why do you think it's important to mark the type of scenario that this is?
So you know what you're doing.
So that you know what you're doing.
Yeah, I don't know what form you're doing.
You know what form you're doing. Well, you already know the names of the forms. So
you want them to pull in the right form.
Well, you're pulling in the forms. We're going to pick them out. So the main reason why you have to mark the appropriate type is so that when you start adding the folks that are going to be part of this deal, we're going to say Michael Jordan, tenant, LeBron James, landlord. Based on the fact that this is a residential lease, Transaction Desk will now know where to add each person's name into the appropriate slots on the forms. And this is also needed for the signatures so that they're not placed in incorrect spots. So even though it's not required, guys, make sure that you fill in the type so that you don't have problems later on with where the system adds the names for you.
Yeah, So in other words, the type of tenant on the lease? No.
Yeah, no, in this case, you're just saying residential lease.
Right. So, and the system will know, okay, you're adding a landlord. So, because they're a landlord and all of this package of paper is going to be for a lease, now I know where to add their name. That's essentially what this is for. The import data, that's already been completed. So add me as the what. This is the same idea. The system needs to know in case there are any boxes within the forms in which you need to sign or you need to be listed. The system needs to know where to put you. Are you the listing agent or are you the selling agent? Or are you neither or are you both? Today we are representing the tenant, so we're the what?
Selling agent.
It's already there. And then we want to make sure that we're using the wizard. The wizard is the easiest way to create a transaction folder. Hit create. Transaction desk will now auto-populate the information coming from the listing. So that's why the address is there, legal description is there. It even brings the remarks from the realtor. So are there any forms that use the remarks on a listing? Do you know of any? No. There aren't any. There aren't any forms that uses the remarks from the listing. So even though it brings them over, it doesn't mean that these remarks are going to go into any of your documents. Think of this wizard as transaction desk sitting down with you and asking you a series of questions. Hey, what is this deal about? What are the who's involved and which sheets of paper do you want to use? So in this case, the remarks, even though they're there, we could leave them there. They're not going to be filled in into any part of the forms or documents because there isn't a remarks slot. Mm-hmm. Or if we wanted to, we could just delete them. Really up to you. And there's a question. So this is the master folder. When you input your transaction data, is it going to say the new data? Template that we just created? My keyboard comes back. And are you there? So if the question is being asked about the transaction template, the template is just giving you a guideline that you create. That you're working with the same scenario, the system now knows what to fill in for you. It's just to save time. But it isn't a master folder by any means. It's just a template that guides you through the process. Okay. It brought in the listing information. Ivan, can you mute the online views, please? Thank you. Online views, I'm not. Can you mute the online viewers? Online viewers. Oh, I think everyone's muted, Alicia. Hold on. Mute all. Okay, I just told this. This is the first time I'm working with this software, so pardon me if I. What I did is I clicked on mute everyone, so everyone's muted. All right, let me know if that works. As far as the listing information that it brought in, so it brought in $3,500 list price. If we go to MLS, that's the amount, $3,500 a month. So we got these folks to give us the property for $3,400 a month. Let's go back to transaction desk. Would I enter this under purchase price?
One would hope,
she says. Yeah, we're not buying it today. So for that reason, we're going to, even though it's asking us enter a purchase price, it doesn't apply to our scenario, which means that every time that you use this wizard, you will leave boxes blank. It's okay, it's just a wizard. The more you enter, the better, because now transaction desk has the information to fill in those boxes for you on the forms. But if you don't know it or it doesn't apply, it's okay to leave it blank. You will then fill it in manually. In this case, I just have to scroll down a tab to the lease information section. That's where I would put in the $3,400 a month. So come on, keyboard. In the meantime, though, 333. you know what? We settled for 333333 a month. Fine. Okay. So the system also asks you the total lease value, which is that one field on the contract to lease that says, for the duration of this lease, the person will pay X. There isn't a calculator within the transaction. You're going to have to go 3333 times 12. So it's $39,996. Sounds like a pretty good down payment for a home. Come on, keyboard. There we go. 333 again. $39,996. And remember, if you don't fill it in there, you can still fill it in manually. At this point, you know, we check the other fields for the purposes of class. I'm just going kind of speed through this, but we're running for 10, like we did do our due diligence, and we check that all boxes that we needed to fill in are filled in. So once we're done, we will hit next. The second step deals with the dates for your deal. These are dates that will end up going into the forms for you. Listing date. Is the list date important on a contract to lease or even the lease?
No.
No. You can still add it. It's not going to be added because there's no box in the form to put it in. So with that being said, let's just worry about the lease dates. Yeah, that's definitely important. So LeBron is expecting Michael Jordan to move in by May 1st. So I can click on the date or I can type it in manually. For those of you that want to use the calendar, let's talk about the lease end date. It's going to be a 12-month lease expiring April 30th, 2020. So when I see the calendar, I just have April 2019. What I can do is I can go month to month, 12 clicks to get to the next April, or I can click on the combination of the month and the year. I now have all of the months for that year. Change the year to 2020, click on April, and now select the date. So you can go that route as well.
I mean, I can't see that well because it's really bright in the background.
Okay.
When you clicked on that 2020, did the date pop up? Did the year pop up or did you?
Yes. Here, I'm going to do it again. So we're at April 2020.
Right.
When
so
you click on that combination.
Year to go to the next year, so you click the following
yeah,
year
see? You have these arrows that let you switch between years.
Gotcha. Okay. Gotcha.
Much faster. After a while, you're going to type it in. That's what I've come to do. Just type it in, you know. Month, /day, /4-year combination for the year. Four-digit year. Okay. We're going to just use these two. That is it. I'm going to hit next. So it brings in some contacts. And we have Ivan Hernandez, yeah, that's me, I'm the selling agent. We have DeBoer as the selling broker. But where did Linda come from? Who's Linda? Who's Balestrieri, the listing broker? Where did it bring this information from? From MLS, that's because I used that MLS integration. Yeah, we're going to have to deal with Linda at some point. So it's nice that it adds these people as contacts. Because both their name is going to go into the forms where they need to go. And also, we now have their contact information to begin the e-signed invitation. So that's also nice. Who are we missing, however?
Yourself.
You said yourself? Well, I'm there.
Yeah,
I'm there.
You're missing the tenant.
I'm missing the tenant. Yes. So I'm going to hit add. And in this case, you can create a new contact or add an existing contact or add a contact from Google. It imports contact records from Google. It will not import your contacts from MLS, unfortunately, but it will bring them in from Google if you use a Gmail account. So that's an option for you to import contacts. Creating a contact is very easy. We're going to create someone today. For this one, I'm going to add an existing contact because Michael Jordan and I go way back. So I already have his contact information. Okay? I'm going to select him. And I'm going to hit add. So Michael Jordan is there. And it confirms the type. Tenant, Michael Jordan. And then this is the person's email address. I'm going to hit save. Awesome. We have Michael Jordan. We need to add LeBron. I'm not going to add LeBron just yet because I want to show you how to create a contact after the wizard is over, should you forget to add someone during the wizard. We're going to click on next. Let's say I'm tired for the training. Training's over, guys. I'm going to stop the training here. I'm going to hit save and exit. I'm just kidding, but let's say that you're tired for the day and you don't want to work anymore on this deal. You want to pick it up the next morning. So when you hit save and exit, it's going to save this progress. When you get back into Transaction Desk, so we're going to go back to Realtor Dash, we're going to click into Transaction Desk, we're going to load Transaction Desk again, but we now have a transaction, you know, the one we created, we saved it. To resume at step four or step three that we were at, we're going to open the transaction. And then on the right-hand side, you now have a wizard option, which will resume at the point where you left off. Mm-hmm. If you don't see the sidebar, you got to click on the little sandwich icon, top right. Click on the sandwich icon, and it opens the sidebar on the right-hand side. So if you don't see the sidebar, click on this icon, and it's going to open up or reveal the sidebar. And all you need to do is click on wizard. There we go. We're back at the point where we left off. So any questions so far? So far, so good, right? Any questions from online?
Wait a minute. To resume, you go to transaction, then transaction, and then wizard.
Yeah, to resume, you click on the transaction that's been saved.
Yeah, and then wizard.
And then wizard. Yeah.
Do you have to go to wizard, or can you just click on the transaction, open it, and start?
You can click on the transaction and add things manually, mm-hmm. but remember that the wizard just makes it a little bit simpler. Yeah. It's up to you.
Okay.
Yep.
Yes. Has this ever made a mistake?
As far as?
As far as putting the wrong information in
Here's something that we'll do after the wizard is over. It is your responsibility to go back to each form, because keep in mind that the wizard is not asking you enough questions to get every single box in the form filled in. It will never ask you all of the questions. It's just like a master guideline. But there will be things that apply that the wizard is not asking you. Like, for example, smoking. Did it ask us, was there a box there that the landlord allows smoking in the premises? No. We still have to go back into the form and check that box. So that's where you would have to exercise due diligence of filling in all of the forms appropriately. Okay, I'm going to hit next. So now we're at forms. What would have happened if I had used a template? Just double checking your, if you're following along, or if you're getting the material.
It would have come up.
It would have added the forms that I had added to that template. So I wouldn't have to choose them again. But in this case, I decided not to use the template. So I'm going to add them manually. You can always add more forms or erase them all. And yeah, you can do it through the add feature. Hit add, it opens up the database again. So it's, you know, just type in what you're looking for. I'm just going to add the contract to lease. There it is, contract to lease. Add it. Just like that, we have a contract to lease. Awesome. So now we can go to the next step, which is a document. And there's already a document, a fax back cover sheet. Let me open it so that you can see what this is for. This cover sheet will allow you to receive a fax, and the contents of that fax will go right into that transaction folder. So, you know, let's say that you have a client that needs to send you a will, power of attorney, and they don't have a scanner. They live far away. They still have a fax machine. So what you can do is you can email them this cover sheet. The only thing that they will need is to print it out. Make sure that that's the first page on the fax. And then when they fax it, going or calling this number, because of this barcode, transaction desk will know that the contents of that fax need to go into that folder. And that's how you receive faxes in transaction desk without the need of a phone number. Completely free of charge. The only requirement is that the person has a printer to print this cover sheet.
And dial that number.
And dial that number. Some of you may still find value into maybe getting a fax number. You may want a fax number and maybe use it for your business cards or whatever the case may be. You can purchase a fax number. In my opinion, it's very inexpensive. So to do this, let me show you where you would go to purchase a fax number. You're not buying it from the board. This is directly from the software company. But if you have questions about getting a fax number, we will go to set up again.
And under the board gives you one.
Under, no, we don't give fax numbers.
You used to.
We have one. Many, many years ago, but not anymore. Now you have to buy it from the company.
Why would you need them to fax it back if you're going to sign electronically?
Like, let's say that, so she just asked for our online viewers, why would they need us fax it back if they're going to sign it electronically? Well, let's say that it's a will that you still need to include into that package, or a power of attorney. It's just an example of a document that you need to add into your stack of paper. So that's why they would need to fax you something. Going back to buying a fax number, should you want one, the fax number can then be purchased from, and let me just look for, program settings. And then under program settings, we're going to go to fax settings. And under fax settings, we will click here on where it says, click here to renew your dedicated number for a year, if you had a number before. If you don't have a number, it's going to say, click here to purchase a number, should you want one. And these are the options that are available from the software vendor. So you can get a local fax number for $50 per year, or a toll-free number for $70 a year. That's something that if it interests you, you can definitely purchase it directly from Instanet Solutions.
So where do you get that form again? That other form?
That's already included in your transaction. It's going to generate every time for your transaction. A fax back, so fax it back, cover sheet. You have a question?
I had a question about that.
Okay.
Cover sheet.
Okay.
When you send that, when you choose, because you don't always have, you don't have to send the fax cover sheet. When you say, okay, send the fax cover sheet, is it good to everybody or only good to your client?
No. So, good question. She just asked online, she just asked, or here at the office, she just asked, and what was your name again? I'm sorry.
Carmela.
Carmela just asked, what if I need to send that cover sheet? Does it send the fax cover sheet to all of the participants? No. I'm about to show you how you would need to email it to someone. So, this is the way. Let me get out from the options to purchase the number. We're going to go back into the cover sheet. But when you have the cover sheet pulled up, all you do is you click download, and then you email it as an attachment. Or the other way is that if you do see your client and they say, I'm going to go back home and I'm going to fax you that will or that power of attorney, you can print it out. They'll take it with them, and then they'll fax it back. That's how you would use it. And then, let's see, Joelle, she would just go to Goodwill to get a fax machine from the 90s. Okay, that works too. A little bit cheaper. She would just have to get the line. All right. So the cover sheet is going to be included into all transactions. Doesn't mean that because it's there, it's going to appear as one of your sheets of paper. for the final, no. It's only, the only way to pull it up is by clicking on it and either downloading it or printing. Well, as far as documents are concerned, that's where we would hit the add button, because there's documents that we need to add. So two ways that you can do this. The first way, I'm going to go to this computer. Let's pretend like you're on your computer and I have some sort of a file here that I know that I need to include as a document. What you can do is drag and drop into this box. You know, if you have PDF files on your computer. Another way that you can do this is, and let me expand this, you click on this blue box and it's going to go into your computer and you just pick out the file that you need to include. That's the document. Remember, documents are read-only files.
So if you had something you wanted to add to that lease, because there's nowhere in the contract where you can like write something.
We'll go over those options.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll get to that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So that's one of the ways that you can add a document, read-only file. Another way that you can do this is by using this service called DocBox. And DocBox is a storage space where you can add documents. And the beauty about the DocBox is that it doesn't matter where you open Transaction Desk, you will have all documents already stored. For example, I'm using this company's computer to do this training, but I already have the documents added into the DocBox, meaning I can pull them from any browser. The DocBox is going to be available here through this icon, DocBox. DocBox. It looks like a box with paper. So if you need to add documents into the DocBox, you can use the document upload button on your home page, or you can go directly into the DocBox. You will go into my folders. You would then add some sort of folder, whatever you want to call the folder, like office documents to include in signing or whatever. And after you add the folder, now you will hit add, and then you will add a new document. And then you would drag and drop it from your computer. When the system uploads it to that DocBox, it's there and it will follow you anywhere you open Transaction Desk.
That's only for documents.
That's only for documents, yeah. The forms, you already have them through Instant Forms. You already have that database in there. But if you want to have documents that follow you, no matter where you open up Transaction Desk, make sure that you upload them to DocBox every time. That way they're there and you can pull them up. So for example, I had uploaded a rental application that I'm going to pretend like my office uses. And that rental application needs to be filled in by the tenant. So I'm going to include that as one of the sheets of paper that need to be into this transaction folder. So I'm going to go back to our transaction. Step 5 out of 5, adding documents. Because I don't have that rental application on this computer, but I do have it on my DocBox, and I'm going to hit copy from DocBox. Because I know I have it in my folders, and I have it in the office documents to include in signing, I'm going to include the rental application. Then I'm going to hit save. And now the system adds that rental application.
How did you go back? Because I can't see the person. How did you go back to add that?
No. So what I did is I showed you how to add it through DocBox, but you have to do this before creating a transaction.
Right. I've read. But how, like right now, how did you go back? Did you just hit a back button?
No, there's no back button. No.
So you just opened the...
I just opened the DocBox. Right. So that you see where I added the file. A lot of people think of the DocBox as a online storage space, a cloud. You just add documents as you need to, and they follow you anywhere you need to go. Step 5 out of 5, we're done. Transaction Desk even reminds you at the end to use transaction templates, like the one that we started the class with. It saves you a lot of time. I'm going to hit done. And now we have the transaction dashboard created with the forms that I put in through the wizard, the document that I added through the wizard, and the contacts that I added through the wizard. So far, AuthentiSign is empty. That's because I haven't told transaction desk yet what I need to be e-signed. Obviously, we need to go through this contract to lease to make sure that all of the appropriate boxes are filled in. So for the time being, we have Michael Jordan, prospective tenant, but we're missing LeBron James. I mean, I could add the person in here manually, type in LeBron James, but the best way to do this is by doing it from the home page of the transaction. So I'm gonna hit file, exit, so that I can go back into the main page of the transaction. And if you wanna add a contact after the wizard is over, click on the plus sign under contacts. Create a new transaction contact. Yes. So the type, that would be, we're adding LeBron now. He's the landlord. And the first name, LeBron. Last name, James. LeBron has a company, and his company must show into all legal paperwork. This is something that might be common to you or a common request from other people. If you ever get this kind of request, you would add the company name under legal name. You're still adding a LeBron James as a contact, but anytime that LeBron's name is used, the legal name is going to override the first and last name. So that's in case that happens. Like a legal name could be LeBron Inc. That's the name of his company. And that's the name that will appear on all forms. Email address. Okay, so it's not a required field. But how are we going to get LeBron an invite to sign this contract to lease? So we call Linda. Linda is the listing agent of that renter. Hey, Linda, how are you? Can you give me your client's name so that I can build a contract to lease? No, I'm not going to give you my client's name. You're going to steal my client. Okay, she has a point. So one way that we dodge that bullet is by going into public records. And we find out that the registered owner's name is LeBron Inc. Awesome, LeBron James. So we added the contact. We call Linda again. We try to be as nice as we can. Hi, Linda, how are you? Happy Wednesday. Happy hump day, whatever. Can I get the email address to your client so that I can send them the invite to sign the contract to lease and review the document? No, you're going to steal my client with the email address. Fair, okay? You may feel that way as well. So we're not going to add an email address for LeBron James. It's not requiring one. It only requires the name so that it can put the name into the form. When we're going to do an authentic sign, we're going to tell the system that we don't know the email address of that person and that someone is responsible for forwarding that request to LeBron. And the person would be the listing agent. So we'll see how that works. This is a feature that you will use extensively. So for the time being, we're good. LeBron James, no email address, we don't have it, and the legal company name is LeBron Inc. Safe. Awesome. So now when I click on the form again, notice how LeBron Inc. is going to be showing as the landlord. There it is. This is where I said you need to exercise due diligence, make sure that all appropriate boxes are filled in, everything is good to go. So we're not going to spend much time on the content of the form. That's more if you do have questions about the content of a form. Everyone knows about the legal hotline, right? Mm-hmm. Online, yes, everyone knows about the legal hotline.
Yeah.
Just as a reminder, if you don't know what I'm talking about, the legal hotline is available from your realtor dash by clicking on this link. The Florida Legal Hotline is a service that you pay through your dues from the Florida Association of Realtors. These are licensed attorneys that can answer any questions about the forms or anything dealing with real estate law. So use it. All right, see, smoking, prohibited. Pets, prohibited. So let's look at these initial boxes. They're gonna have to initial them, but they're not there yet. reason being is because we haven't yet told the system that this needs to go into electronic signing. That's why there's no signing blocks here. As a matter of fact, we're missing a form. We forgot to add a form. So, you know, I'm going to pretend like I'm doing utilities, except for that. That's not included, okay? When I go to file, do you think I have to hit save? Save the changes I've made to the form? Everyone here is saying yes. Probably at home you're saying yes. Not necessary. When you hit exit, Transaction Desk will save any changes on your behalf. See, I'm going to go back to the form just so that you know I'm telling the truth. I'm going to go back. See, pets are prohibited, smoking is prohibited, and this is the utility that's not included. It's save, and I didn't hit the save button. So we forgot to add a form. And the form is going to be, in this example, I'm going to use the one that's typically used for sales or purchases, which is the addendums. The addendum form has one big blank space in the middle, allowing you to add any addendums to the deal. So if I click on the plus sign within forms, I can add additional forms after the wizard. I'm going to type in addendum. Come on, keyboard. There we go. Addendum to FARBAR contract for sale and purchase. Yeah, today we're working with a rental, but this is just for an example. I'm going to add this form. The form gets added. So I click on it so that I can see what Transaction Desk has populated. They populated LeBron as the seller, Michael Jordan as the buyer. Okay, fine. And this is where you can add additional items or conditions as part of the contract. There was a question here about this. So you could type in those conditions. And I'll just say, come on, keyboard. There. And then next one. And then the next one. Okay? Pretty simple. But there's another tool within Transaction Desk that might make it faster for you. And we're going to talk about the clauses feature on any form. So as long as the line is a multi-line box, meaning it's not just one line, but it will allow you to type multiple lines, you can use this feature up here, clause. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to click on clause, and I'm going to look at my personal clauses. And in here, I'm going to select the clauses that I have added to my profile. And when I hit OK, it adds those clauses. Mm-hmm. I typed in those clauses. You have to type in your own clauses. Your broker may also add clauses into the office profile. But then again, that's your broker's prerogative. If there are no office clauses, then the office box is going to be empty. And we're about to see how to add a clause. Because for now, I'm just demonstrating the feature. Now we have to show you how to get those clauses in the system. The way that this is done is through, I'm going to go back to the home page. You will go back to setup.
What?
Setup.
Yeah.
When you click setup, you're going to go to the clauses feature. So system clauses are reserved for the board. If you go into system clauses at some point, you're just going to see dummy clauses that are used for examples. They don't have any validity. Office clauses, that's where if the broker so wants to, could add clauses for the office to use, for all of the agents to use. But you have the responsibility of managing your personal clauses. So when you click on personal clauses, you will see a history of any clauses you've created in the past. If you haven't created any, this will be empty. So we're going to add a clause today. I'm going to hit add, top right. add new clause, or you could add a new folder. Why would you want to add a folder? Let's see if I get some volunteers here.
Because you want to put all your clauses in one place.
I think more is to be organized, because you can have a folder for your sales clauses. You can have another folder for your rental clauses. You could have another folder for your short sale clauses, just to stay organized. It's not required that you create a folder, but it just makes it a little bit more organized. So I'm just going to create a new clause, and it just asks me for two things, a title and the content. So we're going to call this the ice cream clause. And the content of the clause is landlord agrees to buy tenant ice cream upon moving. I'm going to hit save. And now that this clause, the ice cream clause, is in the system, when I go into my form, yeah, I could type it in all over again, or I could just go into clause, go into the personal clause, select the ice cream clause, hit OK, and it's going to add it. Landlord agrees to buy tenant ice cream upon move. And then I can put it into the appropriate location. So the clauses feature will save you time. Definitely. Any questions about clauses? Okay. Some features that you have available when you're modifying a form, you could change the text. You know, you could change it to Helvetica. Mm-hmm. You could change the size if you wanted to. You could even change the color. Mm-hmm. So you can turn everything purple. I once got a question at a class in which I was asked, Ivan, what if I change the color? Will that render the document void because I'm not using black or blue? So I said, you know what? I don't know. I'm going to call the legal hotline. And the legal hotline explained to me that imagine if someone is handwriting a form with a red pen. It still has validity. But with that being said, also keep in mind that professionalism is at stake here. Don't turn in a sheet of paper with purple font. You know, it doesn't look professional. So just exercise good judgment. That's all I can say about that. Something else, let me just change it back to black. All right. Other favorites from other agents are the watermark feature. Let's say that you're doing a rough draft that your client needs to review the form, and you want to eliminate all possibility of it ever becoming an actual legal document. What you can do is add a watermark that's called draft. And it's going to place draft all over the screen. I guess because of the projector, at least here at the office, we can't see the watermark. But it's there. It adds a watermark. I don't know if the folks at home can see the watermark. But it's there. If you need to remove that watermark, you will just go back to the folder, go back to the watermark icon, and hit remove. And then that removes the watermark. The confidential one, I haven't heard of too many people using it. I couldn't tell you what to, in which instances to use it, but if you find purpose for it, use a confidential watermark is what you want. I'm going to hit exit. Remember, you don't have to hit the save button. And we're done with our forms. We now have two forms plus this rental application, and we're ready to begin a signing event. These are called signing events. Why are they called signing events? Well, in today's situation, we're representing the tenant. We're going to be sending a contract to lease. And the contract to lease is going to have the rental application included for the listing side and the landlord to review. They said that they're going to send the lease should they approve the deal. So when they send the lease back, we now have to create a second signing event called the lease. That's why each one is called an event. You can create as many authenticines events as you need to within a transaction folder. Let's create the first event. I'm going to hit the plus sign within the authenticine box. You can do it this way, directly from the transaction. Or you can do it from your home page. I'm going to go to the home page. If I click the authenticine pen on the home page of Transaction Desk, it's going to ask me for a name, what I want to call that signing event, and if I want to pair it with a transaction. Whereas if you do it directly from the transaction folder, it's not going to ask you to pair it with a transaction because you're already in the transaction. So you can do it either way, whatever is easiest for you. I'm just going to do it from here. So the signing name, contract to lease, Montana, or keyword. There we go. Contract to lease. And if anything, I'm going to add the address. 1790 Southeast 3rd Street. Go to new signing. Because when I hit save, it's going to walk me through another wizard. Transaction Desk is all about wizards to make it easier for you. So let me zoom in some more. There we go. Step one. The signing name, I already gave that, contract to lease. But the participant order, you have two options. You can either send invites to all participants at the same time. Everyone signs when they can. And once the last person has signed, then everyone will get executed copies. Or sign, that was simul-sign, which is first come, first serve. Sign in line is the one in which you specify the order, who's signing first, who's signing second, who's reviewing third, who's signing fourth. So in today's example, because we're setting up Linda, the listing agent, as the person that needs to review before she forwards to her client, we're gonna go with sign in line. Anytime that you're missing an email address for an invite, you must use sign in line. Because remember, you're making someone responsible for relaying the invite to another person. That's all. Some advanced options. Agent favorites, this reminder one. Because you can ask Transaction Desk to send a reminder as little as every 4 hours to the person that is up at bat to sign. Somebody just sends emails, polite emails saying, hey, you have to sign. Hey, you have to sign. Hello, you have to sign. You know, and some agents have told me that in case the signer gets upset at the constant emails, they just say, you know, it's the computer that's doing it. It's not me. Don't blame me. Just sign. So that's an agent favorite, the reminders feature. In this case, we're going to go to step two, which is now to review the participants. And because we tied this up to a transaction in which we had specified the people involved, that's why we see that list, the people that are involved. Linda, Ivan, Michael Jordan, and LeBron Inc. So everyone's involved. I'm going to select everybody. By default, Transaction Desk is going to set up the agents as reviewers. The actual people involved, buyer, seller, tenant, landlord, they're going to be remote signers as their type. Just so you know, in-person signer is a feature that's not used a lot, but this is what it does. Let's say that you have someone that doesn't trust electronic signing. They may say, no, I may get hacked, blah, 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 etc. Okay. What you can do is you can say this person has to sign in person. They're still signing digitally, but they're not signing from their computer. They're going to be signing from your computer. All they're going to get on their invite is a PIN. And they have to bring this PIN to your computer, type in the PIN onto your computer. The system now knows that it's them and they can do the electronic signing. But the reason why this feature is not used that often is because if they already came to your computer, wouldn't it be easier to just hand them a pen and get them to sign? That's the main reason why. In-person signer, even though it's available, it's not used quite often. Today we're going to go with remote signers for Michael Jordan and LeBron, and we're also going to have the agents, the realtors, sign at some point. Or Linda's just reviewing. I'm going to hit add. I'm going to sign some. So Linda is the first person at bat. Do we want her to get all of the documents first? No. Because remember, my client, Michael Jordan, has to first agree for the contract to lease and fill out the application, the rental application that I included. So Michael Jordan goes first. To switch him from the third spot, I just click on the arrow. Go number two, go to number one. Mm-hmm. After Michael Jordan signs and everything is good, I want to review it and also sign. So I'm going to go second. Then Linda goes third. Yeah, she has to review. After I'm done, let's get her to review. Fourth, LeBron. And why do you think there's a red hand? Because there's no email. Yes, even though it wasn't required, the only way that we're going to get LeBron an invite is through email. When I click on the red hand, it says, this participant is missing required information. So I hit OK. And right away it says name, okay, but the email is blank. Because we don't have their email, we're going to click this checkbox called private email. It's an email address that is privately held. So I'm going to select it, and when I do this, the system now asks me who's responsible for privately providing that email address for forwarding. So it's going to be Linda. When Linda reviews, she's going to get a box that says, please enter the email address for LeBron James so that the invite can go to that person. And at no point, even though she's putting it in, will I see that email address. So hit save participant. I needed to cover that the privacy, it's important. Custom signature, yeah, there's no custom signature here. Save participant. Oh, but in this case, yeah, it's LeBron James. Even though his company name is LeBron Inc. So I do have to put in, oh, there. Okay, save participant. But yeah, I needed to make sure that everyone knows that the privacy is kept. This is because, as I was sharing earlier, all members have access to transaction desk, all members of the Palm Beach Greater Fort Lauderdale Board. So if you do get an invite from someone and you're representing the list side, whenever you get an invite like that that says enter the email address for your client, you can rest assured that you can put it in without fear of the other side seeing that email address ever. Okay. Michael Jordan, Ivan, Linda, LeBron. Awesome. So let's go to step three. We're done with our participants. Let's go to the documents. Because I paired this to the transaction, it's going to give me all of the documents that I have added so far. I added the rental application, and then as far as the forms, the contract to lease and the addendum. I want all of them included. I'm going to hit add. Add them. Awesome. But before we go any further, we now have to confirm to AuthentiSign each person's role. So it added Michael Jordan and LeBron James as buyer and seller because we're using that addendum form. Remember, this is just for class purposes. But in a real life scenario, they would be landlord and tenant. We still have to add them as tenant number one, Michael Jordan, landlord number one, LeBron James. And we hit save. So the same idea with the location of the forms. This is how, when they get the invites, they're going to review them. We just changed the location. Contract to lease goes first, then after the lease, the addendum could go second, and then after that, the rental application is third. Who can tell me why there's yellow boxes on these two and not on the third one?
You didn't put them there.
I didn't put them there. Why? It's an application, but an application is a what? It's a fill-in, but it's a form, but in this scenario, it's more of a document. Because we can't magically give it boxes for it to be filled in. This is something that we'll do later. The reason why these boxes appear here is because Transaction Desk already knows the boxes that become the form. But for the purposes of the rental application, we're going to have to do that manually. So for the time being, it's just a document. Right?
Let me get my phone.
Let's go to design. Step four. So here's a contract to lease. Notice how, because it's a form, Transaction Desk has already included the appropriate initials boxes in the right locations. Make sure that they are in the right location. If you see that they're not in the right location, you can still move them. You can click on it and move it to a new location. Place it here, or place it here, whatever the case may be. In this case, they are in the right location, so I'm going to leave them as is. Here's the signer, prospective tenant, prospective landlord, and also a date. This date is automatic based on the date when they actually approve the document. So you send invites today, but they only get to it tomorrow. The date that will be registered will be tomorrow's date, not today's. So let's talk about, okay, the addendum of the contract. Oh yeah, see, here's the watermark. We can now see it here at the office. Right. Michael Jordan, LeBron James. So this is a rental application. This is what we're gonna have to get Michael Jordan to fill in for the purposes of passing the condo or HOA, whatever the scenario is. Applicant information, last name. Well, he won't be able to fill it in. So we now have to use the drag and drop feature so that he can fill things in. Drag and drop is typically used for adding signature boxes or initial boxes or date boxes. So let me go to the bottom of this where the person would sign, right? You would drag and drop a signature box, and then you would drag and drop a timestamp box. So that when Michael Jordan signs, and it's their turn to sign, they will click on them and it will record their signature. You can change the person that's signing up here. Michael Jordan, Ivan Hernandez, LeBron James, as you deem necessary. In our scenario, so I'm going to set it to LeBron. LeBron is the landlord. Will LeBron fill in the applicant information? No, LeBron doesn't fill that in. It's Michael Jordan. And the problem is that if I use drag and drop under LeBron James, it's recording anything under LeBron's turn at bat. So for that reason, I must change it to Michael Jordan so that whatever I add only applies to Michael Jordan's turn at bat when they have the sign, meaning the boxes. You see this T? That's a text box. I can drag this text box and set it here under last name. I can resize it. And what's going to happen is that when Michael Jordan sees this box, he now knows that because it's under last name, he has to type in the last name. And just like that, you're creating your own custom form. Yes?
Could you make like three little things?
Or yeah.
Do one long one?
No, you can do one long one, okay. Or you can do, here, you can do one for the first name. Resize it. Maybe a little one for the middle, right? So resize it. So we have a lot of boxes here.
Yeah, that's a lot.
There's a lot of boxes. It's going to take you some work to get the first one done. But we're saying that this form is a form that we use often. We use this form. So one of the things that you could do is after you're done populating all of the boxes that whoever will sign, I can go to layouts. And I can save this as a layout so that it's going to save the boxes in the appropriate slots and their size. I already have a layout for this whole form. Watch what it does. So I'm going to apply a layout. And the layout that I created is for the rental application. And it's going to ask me, which layout do you want to use? The rental application layout. Okay, the signer type, tenant one. Who's the tenant one? That's Michael Jordan. Hit apply. Watch what happens. So we now go back. These are the forms we created. And look at the rental application with all of the boxes. All I need to do is go through the work the first time to assign the boxes, mm-hmm. save it as a layout, and then you can use that layout over and over and over and over again. And just like that, you have a custom form. Yes.
One question. Yes. How did you get? What are the difference with the drag and drop the X's to get those X's over there?
Yeah, the X's.
Blue and a red one.
Correct. Anything in red means it's mandatory.
Okay.
Anything in blue is optional. So like these here are red, meaning the person must fill them in order to complete the signing process. I created some of them blue, meaning they can be skipped. And for the purposes of demonstration, I would skip some of them. But when you have a form, my personal recommendation is that you set every box as required so that the person doesn't fill or doesn't skip any of the boxes. Something else that you can do for any of these boxes, you can click on the box and click on the settings button for that box. In the settings button, that's where you can make it optional or not. See, so this one, because it's unchecked for is optional, it's now a required one. You can also do a tooltip, which means that when the person hovers over the box, they're going to see some sort of tip. So you can say first name. Type in your first name. Type in first name. You know, it's like you're telling them what to do. They just hover over the box and it gives them a pop-up. So those are available. Yes.
I'm just going to clarify. So as long as we don't hit the is optional button, it will come up red.
Right. By default, anytime that you add one of these boxes, it's going to be an optional one. So you're going to have to switch it to required one by one. So like this one, for example, social security number. Yeah, we need that for the application. Click on it. Click on the settings button. Notice how his optional is checked. Mm-hmm. So when I unselect it, it now becomes red. Mm-hmm. And just a quick cheat to get this process a little bit quicker. One of the things that you can do is let's say that this box, the size of the box and the settings of the box, I'm gonna pick on the social security one. The settings of the box are appropriate to go into other fields. So one of the things I like to do is just say, copy. And then what I can do is paste, and it's going to paste the box that I just need to place wherever it needs to go. Mm-hmm. And that's the quickest way for you to then reorganize the boxes as you need it. But remember, after you organize it, make sure you go to layouts, you save it as a layout, give it a name, mm-hmm. so that you don't have to do this over and over again. Because at first it does take time, but afterwards it's going to save you a lot of time. Yes, ma'am.
Is that any different than when you added the rental application into your Dropbox when you did that a couple steps ago?
Yeah, when I added the sheet of paper.
Right.
It was already printed, but remember that the sheet of paper doesn't have the ability for it to be filled in electronically.
So you couldn't have saved that sheet of paper application like this. You have to put that in first.
I have to give it the magic.
Drag and drop.
Right. I have to give it the magic of it now being filled in electronically.
After.
And that's how you use the drag and drop in the T so that it becomes a form. Quote unquote form. So any questions about dragging and dropping either signatures or date boxes or even these exits. Notice how I set up for rent or own. Do you rent or own? So I set them up as optional because I'm not sure if Michael Jordan, the last resident or the current residence, he rents or he owns. He would just click on the one that's appropriate. Any questions online? Okay, later on, we're going to receive the lease and we're going to use the markup feature. There's going to be a reason why we'll use the markup feature. So you will see that in action. Because I'm done with these forms, everything is good to go. Then I'm going to hit next. Not all required participants, mandatory sign. Oh, Ivan Hernandez. Yeah, I forgot to give myself a signing block. You know what, I'm just going to say I need a sign here next to the ice cream one. So I need to change the signer to Ivan. Now that Ivan is enabled, then I go to drag and drop and Ivan will have to initial me. Here. Ivan initials there. That's all he needs to do. Awesome. I'm going to hit next. Now everyone has a signing block. And this is where the system says, hey, do you want to send invites? Yes, I do. But an option that you have before you send the invites is that you can customize invitation emails so that when that person receives the invite, they only see a custom message for them. Like Michael Jordan, that's my signer. So I can say contract to lease, attached. And then I'm going to say, Michael, please review the contract to lease so that we may send to your future landlord. I have also included a rental application that you may fill in. Let me know if you have questions. Ivan. Then after that, Ivan is signing. I don't need to write myself a note. I already know what the invite is for. After that, I can tell Linda, contract the lease for, forget the address, 17 something, 1790 Southeast 3rd with rental application. So you see how I'm customizing the message from each participant?
And you can do all that the first time. You can make all your custom things all there, even though you haven't sent it to Linda and you haven't gotten back.
Right. No. These are just messages that are being delivered to just that one person. Right.
But they'll wait until you're ready to.
So the question I got asked here is, these messages won't go all at once. Not in this case, because I use sign in line. So Michael has to go first, then I have to go. After I go, Linda gets her turn. And we'll pretend like we're the signers also, so that you see how that process is done. Contract to lease with rental application. LeBron James. So even though we don't have their email address, you could potentially write a note. I would strongly discourage you from writing anything to the private email. The last thing that you need is an ethics violation because the other agent may say that you were writing secret notes to their buyer or their seller. So don't write anything there. That's all I can say as far as, it's available. But don't write anything there. Linda will tell LeBron what the email is all about. Really quickly, let me just take away this email address. I don't want Linda to actually get a contract to lease. Give me a second. Okay, cool. Save. And now we can send the invites. Authentic signed invitations were successfully sent. So what's going to happen now is that if you were to go back to the transaction, or even your homepage, when you click on the AuthentiSign called Contract to Lease, you're now going to receive each person and whether they've authenticated and signed. So it's like a status. Authenticated means that they've reviewed the document. Signed means that they've signed and reviewed. When something is complete, you're going to see a checkered flag, like the one that's used in racing. You will see a checkered flag. But this is a great way where you can keep track of who has signed, who hasn't signed. You will also receive an email once someone signs saying, so-and-so signed. The next person signed. You can review the document here if you want. So that's available. Let me log into my email, my training email addresses, so that we can see the actual invites. So let me start here. And this is going to take me a moment, so you're more than welcome to take a short break, 2 to 3 minutes, while I log in. All right, so I got the contract to lease. Ivan Hernandez sent it to Michael Jordan. For those of you wanting to know how I was able to get the board's logo into the invite, maybe even a photo, because I could have looked at my photo here. How did I get that in there? To do this, what you needed to do is, let me close this out. We're going to go into setup again. And under setup, when you click on preferences, you're going to go into branding. Make sure that it's set as the FaxBack cover sheet and email banner. That's the email banner. So you can click on it and upload a photo. Make sure that it's adhering to these dimensions. And then your personal photo. Just click on the photo, find the photo, and make sure that it's adhering to these dimensions. But that's one of the ways that people can now attach your name, maybe even your company's name or your team name if you work with a team, or just better branding. That's optional, but I strongly suggest. Yes.
How do you change the Broward name to your company name?
Oh no, this is just an example, but everyone will just go here into preferences, and this will be a blank slot.
Oh.
Yeah. You're not gonna see the RAPD GFLR logo, no. You're gonna see blank. Yeah. You just click on the box. It's a gray one. If you have a logo, like the paid company logo, you can see there's a paid company logo available from the office manager. Or location. Yeah.
Would you change the preferred dimension?
You can use I use Paint, Microsoft Paint. If you have a Mac, you can use iPhoto. Yeah. All right. So to start a signing invitation, the person would click on the pen. It's gonna always want the person to verify they're not a robot. This is where you click on, you know, three fire hydrants or two fire hydrants. Yeah. And it's at random. In this case, it knows that I'm not a robot. I guess I've spoken for so long. So, Michael Jordan, the system is going to want to offer a font style for the signature. But if the person wants to draw their own signature, they can. If they click on draw their signature, they can just draw it. Or if they have a touch screen, they can just use their finger and draw it. M-J-A-D-O-T. So now anytime Michael clicks on a signing box, it's going to use this name and these initials. I'm going to hit accept. And to start the process, very simple. They just hit start. It's a big red button on the top right. They can't miss it. They can review the content of the document. They have to sign here. So to sign, they would click on it. Notice how it replaces it for that handwritten signature that I put in. So they would click here, click here, click here, click here. Oh, look, Michael Jordan, you have to do a rental application. So this box is telling them that they have to start this. They would click here, and now they would put in last name. See how it says type in first name? Well, I should have said last name, but I made a mistake, sorry. So last name, Jordan, and I hit tab. First name, Michael, middle name, X. Social Security, 11111111111. So you see how this is now a form?
Mm-hmm.
And before it was just a simple document that was just a sheet of paper with some stuff printed in it. You made it a form. You made it smart. You know, the person rented before, and you know, they can add information for these optional fields. Previous residence, not applicable there. And that's it. Once they're done, they would hit sign here. And then they're ready to complete, or if they forgot to fill in any of the optional ones, they could go back. That's where the complete button is now available. The complete button in blue will only be available once they process all required fields. All of the ones in red. Jordan, Michael, X. Complete. Complete signing. This is if you want to create an account with AuthentiSign. Everyone is going to get an email once everything is executed, a final copy. All participants will get a final executed copy. But this gives the person the option of creating a password that they can go into AuthentiSign so that they can log in and review the document or later. Honestly, if you're going to get an email at the end with an executed copy, just stick to that email. That's what I recommend. Hi, once the doc is turned into a fill-in form, be saved for use, for future use independent of TD. No, great question. No, the layout that you save, you're only saving it within AuthentiSign. And the only way to use it is by going into layouts and adopting that layout that you create. So what she asked is, will that will that now have form preferences with it if I were to pull it up in a PDF reader? No. No, the layout is only for transaction desk views. Yes.
Did you have to put an initial box for it to bring attention to that application form? Like if you didn't have it there, would it still bring you to the application form to fill out?
Yeah.
Or did you put that little Michael Jordan initial
box? I put in the initial box there, but let's say I didn't put in this initial box because the last name field is required, it would have brought the person to the box and say, hey, you need to do something.
Okay, so we don't need that.
You don't need to.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
But even though they fill in the red, they should fill in all the blue spots too.
Well, of course, if it applies. That's why you're making it optional or not optional.
Right.
Right. Yeah, if I had made, for the purposes of class, if I had made everything red, we would be here filling an actual form. So that's why. Okay. No thanks. I don't want to create an account. And the person now receives a confirmation, which they can print out as legal confirmation that they did sign this document. So real quick, I'm going to go into my phone to approve my side. Remember, I just have to hit one box. Give me a second, because we're now going to pretend like we're Linda. I want you to see how, after she's done reviewing, it asks her for the email address to LeBron. So, should get it a second. There it is. So I did my part, now let me sign into the other email address where I have Linda.
You need a break.
Okay, so now we're pretending like we're Linda. Linda got this invite. See, it even addresses it to her, Linda. Contract to lease for this address. Coming from me, she would click on the magnifying glass because all she's doing is reviewing it. So she has to verify she's not a robot. Going to want Linda to accept that she's just using the service. And she will go through the form, make sure everything is good to go. She reviews the addendum. She sees how I initialed it, my client signed it, and the rental application. Michael Jordan X, Social Security. You know, this is what we did earlier. So she's like, this is good to go. I'm going to forward this to my client. When she clicks accept, notice how it then says, add private email address for participants, LeBron James. And then she would put in the email address for her client. So I'm going to put in an email address. Hit OK. Where's the mouse? Here it is. Accept documents. Going to ask her the password thing. No thanks. And she just completed. If we go back to transaction desk and I check on the progress of the signings, let me go click on contract to lease under AuthentiSign. See how there's now checkered flags for authenticated and signed? And even though Linda has authenticated and in this case reviewed, and she already entered the email address, look how it still exists. You don't see that email address by any means, so it's very secure. We're going to bypass the LeBron part. We already know how easy it is to get something signed. The last part of the class, and this will take us 5 minutes, we'll wrap up by noon. We received the lease. They approved the offer. They sent a handwritten lease. So this part of the class will cover when you receive a form or whatever, either that's handwritten or that comes from another software, like a Form Simplicity, like a Dotloop, like a whatever. They typically email it to you, right? Oh, so we have a lease. Here's a lease. See, they signed. They even said, the company's called me, and the insurance company is my company, and the commission is a lot. Okay, so they signed the landlord's part. Put in the date. We now have to see how we can turn this into an electronic signing for my client, Michael Jordan, to sign. So we're going to have to add it to transaction desk one way or another. You have two options. So I'm back at the home page. We're going to have to go back into the transaction because we now have to add this lease as a document. Remember, it's a non-editable document at this point. At best, we can add signatures to it. So we'll go to documents, hit the plus sign, and you know, because it's in my email, I can save it to my computer, and then drag and drop it into there. But another feature that you have from Transaction Desk is instead of dragging it into your computer, why not forward this with the attachment to Transaction Desk? So here's how we're going to do this. Let me close this up. You see this icon here, email upload? When I click on this, it's going to create a unique email address for that transaction folder. All I do is copy it, and I go into my email. Okay, the lease looks good. Let's forward this email, paste that email address. There it is. I hit send, and in about 3 minutes, this lease will show into your transaction. So we'll just wait for that in a second. It takes about 2 minutes for it to upload. In the meantime, while that's coming in, I just wanted to show you a feature. You know what? I'm just going to approve the LeBron side of things. Why not? While the attachment is coming in. LeBron, awesome start. LeBron. Complete time. Nothing. Okay, LeBron just signed. So, a really nice feature is how do you cover yourself as far as someone saying, look, I didn't sign that? They may say that because it's an electronic signing. So, one of the things that you can always pull up is when you go to the AuthentiSign, contract to lease, once everyone authenticates and signs, you will now have this icon, which is a sheet of paper with a lock. This icon will create something that is called a certificate of authenticity, that all signatures are valid. It's going to show you the name of the person, the time when they signed, and the IP address that was used when they signed. And that is legal proof that all the signatures are valid. You will also get this signing certificate on your email when everyone signs. It's going to be available as a link there as well. Say, Michael, sign from this IP address. I, because I use my phone, my IP address was different. See? So this is your legal proof that the signatures are valid. And you know, you can view it as a PDF, save it, whatever you need to do with it. Okay, let's go back into the transaction. The document should now be there. See, if I go to the transaction, we go to documents, we now have an executed lease. There it is. at this point, we have to turn it into an Authenticsign event. We now need my guy to sign the lease. I'm going to click the plus sign, and I'm going to call this lease for 1790 Southeast 3rd. Go to new sign. Okay. So we're going to go sign in line. We're going to select the participants. Do we add everyone again?
No.
No. LeBron already signed, and he did it with his hand. So all I'm doing is I'm adding Michael Jordan as a signer. If anything, I want Linda there. Will Linda have to sign anything? No, she sent us a lease ready to go. But I do want her to get the copy when Michael signs. So in this case, I'm not even setting her as a reviewer. Set her up as a CC. The CC feature will send a final copy after all signers fully execute the document. So this is a good scenario for you to use this feature. Maybe you want to give a copy to the HOA or the condo association. You can add them as participants, but just make sure that their type is CC so that they get a copy at the end. I'm not going to actually add her, but you get the idea. We do have a problem though. We were checking this contract and we are all in disagreement of section number 25, the tenant's phone number. Michael Jordan says, look, I'm not going to give you the phone number in 5 days. I'm going to give it to you in 10. Okay, so now we're crossing out things from the contract that we all mutually agreed to. You know, we clear this by the legal hotline. The legal hotline says it's okay to cross out. Just make sure you have some initial blocks in there for everyone to make this a valid point. So what I need to do is I do need to add LeBron in there. And once again, you know, I'm going to set him up as a remote signer. Add, because LeBron is going to have to initial that cross out. So in this case, you know what, I needed to add transaction. I needed to add Linda, because Linda is supposed to. Reviewer. Linda's supposed to give LeBron the email address. See, we don't have LeBron's email address. I'm just going to go with Michael here. That's fine. Let me get rid of it. Okay, cool. Now let's go to documents. So the document, the only one we're using is the executed lease. I'm going to add that. And in this scenario, I'm going to go to design, step 4. So that handwritten lease is going to show up in a second. Here it is. What I'm going to do is the signer, Michael Jordan. I'm going to use the drag and drop so that Michael Jordan will have to initial here as a tenant. So you see how manually you're now giving it electronic signing capabilities. You just have to tell the system where each individual needs to sign. Tenant. Tenant. Number 25, the tenant's phone number. We all disagreed on that. We are all okay with crossing that out. So to cross it out, we will use the markup feature. When you click on this line, you will now be able to cross it out. And because both parties have to initial it, you will now say, Michael Jordan, please initial here. Mm-hmm. And then LeBron, please initial here. Coming soon to Transaction Desk, when someone gets a signing invite, they will be able to do their own cross out. And then they come back to you for approval. That's a feature that's being tested. For the time being, you as the maker of the signing, you have to do it yourself, but this is how you do it, through markup. And then finally, Michael Jordan signs here at the tenant, and he puts in the date. And I'm done. Make sure, yep. Save, send invites, And just like that, we sent the lease that was originally handwritten. We gave it some electronic signing to our client. Our client signs, you know, with the CC feature, the other listing agent would receive it. And now you know what to do when you want to cross things out. Use the markup feature with the line. Yes, ma'am, there's a question here at the office.
Yes. Can you only use the cross out or the markup thing after it's been sent? Can you do it when you're preparing the lease, knowing that with a contract to enter into a lease, when you know that there are certain things that you've already discussed with the agent and things that you're not going to have in there?
Right. The easiest way is for you to do it when you're preparing the authentic sign. So we could have done, we could have done it with the contract to lease too.
Gotcha.
You know, when we were preparing it, we could cross things out. But, you know, for the time being, it does require that you call the other side, make sure that those changes are good, and then you put it in. What InstantX Solutions is working on is giving the participants the ability to cross things out while they're signing, and then it comes back to you for approval.
Well, that sounds dangerous.
It's being tested. So it's being tested. It does come back to you for approval.
Well, that's good news.
Yes.
Just to go over it. So when you're inside the transaction, you hit on document, and then that little email thing will appear. Then you hit on that, and that gives you the email address.
Yeah, you can upload anything via email. Whenever you see that envelope, it's going to render that unique email address. Any other questions here at the office? Any questions online? So I gave you a 2-hour view of Transaction Desk as far as the most useful features. But I have to be honest with you, Transaction Desk has so many other things. Like, we didn't cover checklists today.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to know other aspects of Transaction Desk, I invite you to use the support tab, this question box, because that's how I master Transaction Desk. I would typically go into support and watch these webinar videos or these help videos. Mm-hmm. The help videos are usually between 2 to 3 minutes in length, whereas the pre-recorded webinar videos are full classes, an hour, maybe 2 hours long, but those are there available. And then support is available from the association through this number. Once again, any questions here at the office or online? We do have a question here at the office.
Suppose you are doing all of this. How do you know that the other agent is familiar with Transaction Desk and know where to go and what to do?
Or remember how we this is the reason why I wanted to for us to wear the signer hats for a second. That's why I went to this fake email address.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's very simple for them. They hit start and it says in red letters, click here to sign. So it's very simple.
And they'll know that email address that they're putting in, that you're not going to see it and all that.
You may want to write it on that email. You know how you can customize the mm-hmm. invites? Write it on the email or call them. Say, look, I set up the software to ask you for your client's email address so that you can privately forward them the attachment for them to sign. Just know that I will not see that email address for your safety. If there are no other questions about this Transaction Desk class, thank you very much for coming. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
And hope you learned something new today.
Thank you.
And thanks everyone online.
Very, very good.
Are you on the pre-recorded video?